Piper Audio presents Jesus Before the Gospels, how the earliest Christians remembered, changed, and invented their stories of the Savior, by Bart D. Ehrman, read by Joe Barrett. Introduction. Jesus died in about the year 30 CE, but our earliest surviving accounts of his life did not start to appear until some 40 years later, beginning with the Gospel of Mark. During the intervening years, and even in the years after our Gospels were written, stories about Jesus were in oral circulation, starting with tales told by those who were eye and ear witnesses to things he did and said. I am deeply interested in how Jesus was being remembered and misremembered by those who were telling such stories, both those who actually knew him and those who heard stories from others some years or even decades later, before our written Gospels appeared. This book, in short, is about the historical Jesus, memory, and distorted memory. I have been interested in the historical Jesus since I first started studying the New Testament from an academic perspective in the late 1970s. At that time, I heard views from some of my teachers that many people continue to hear today. The Gospels are based on eyewitness reports. They can, therefore, be accepted as historically reliable. People in oral cultures, such as in the ancient Roman world, had better memories than we do today. And such people always preserved their traditions about the past accurately, since they were not literate and so could not learn about the past from writing. Are these views correct? It was just a few years ago that I came to realize that the study of memory, as pursued by scholars who did not work on the New Testament, could provide some valuable and keen insights into such matters. These other scholars work in a number of disciplines well represented in the academy, such as psychology, sociology, and anthropology. Their insights may be especially relevant to understanding how the earliest Christians told and retold the stories about Jesus after his death, but before the Gospels were written. This was a mysterious period of oral transmission, when stories were circulating, both among eyewitnesses and, even more, among those who knew someone whose cousin had a neighbor who had once talked with a business associate whose mother had, just 15 years earlier, spoken with an eyewitness who told her some things about Jesus. How were such people, those people at the tail end of the period of transmission, telling their stories about Jesus? Did they remember very well what they had heard from others, who had heard from others, who had heard from others? Were the stories they told accurate reflections of what they heard, or more remotely of what Jesus said and did, or had their stories been molded and shaped or even invented in the processes of telling, remembering, and retelling the stories? During the 40 to 65 years between Jesus' death and the first accounts of his life, how much had the stories been changed? How much was being accurately remembered? Modern studies of memory may possibly provide us with some much-needed insights into the question. For about 2 years now, I have spent virtually all my free time doing nothing but reading about memory, what cognitive psychologists have to say about individual memories, what sociologists can tell us about collective memory, and what anthropologists have written about oral cultures and the ways they preserve their unwritten traditions. The more I read, the more surprised I became that so many scholars of the New Testament, the vast bulk of them, so far as I can tell, have never explored this research, even though it is so fascinating and most immediately relevant. Even those New Testament specialists who have delved into such fields have, in many instances, limited themselves to just one or possibly two of them. But they are all important. In this book, I try to bring them each to bear on questions about memory and the historical Jesus. Memory and Jesus. When it comes to Jesus, all we have are memories. There are no lifelike portraits from his day, no stenographic notes recorded on the spot, no accounts of his activities written at the time. Only memories of his life, of what he said and did. Memories written after the fact. Long after the fact. Memories written by people who were not actually there to observe him. Critical scholars have long argued that the surviving records of Jesus, the Gospels, are not memories recorded by those who were eyewitnesses. They are memories of later authors who had heard about Jesus from others, who were telling what they had heard from others, who were telling what they had heard from yet others. They are memories of memories of memories. To understand what the Gospels are, and to know anything about the man Jesus himself, we have to know about memory. Our own memories are, on the whole, reasonably good. If they weren't, we would not be able to function, or even survive as human beings in a very complex world. We count on our memories for the thousands of things we do every day, from the moment we wake up in the morning to the time we shut down at night. But we forget a lot of things as well. Not just our keys, and the names of people we are sure we ought to remember, but also factual information that we used to know, and events, even highly important events, that have happened in our lives. Even more disturbing, we misremember things. The older we get, the more we realize we sometimes remember clearly what took place and how it took place. Then it turns out we are wrong. It happens to all of us, and it has happened to everyone who has ever lived, including the followers of Jesus, including the ones who told the stories about him, including the ones who heard those stories and then passed them along to others, including the ones who heard these third-hand stories and told them then to others, who told them to others, who told them to others, who then wrote the Gospels. Each person in that link of memory from Jesus to the writers of the Gospels was remembering what he or she had heard, or trying to do so. When it comes to knowing about the Gospels and about the historical Jesus himself, it is all about memory, and about frail memory, and faulty memory, and false memory. Memory is not simply about us as individuals, as we remember things in our world and information that we have learned, or when we recall events that have happened to us and persons we have encountered. Memory, calling something back to mind, also involves groups of people as they remember what has happened in their collective past. Society itself cannot function without a memory of the people and events that have bound and continue to bind it together. As a society, we have to remember our origins, our history, our wars, our economic crises, our mistakes, and our successes. Without a recollection of our past, we cannot live in the present or look forward to a future. It is astounding how we, individually or as a society, have such different memories of events and people from the past, and how often our recollections of important moments and figures are so far removed from historical reality. Let me give an example of social memory to demonstrate my point. This will help set the stage for what I want to say about memories of Jesus. Remembering Lincoln. In 2014, a poll was taken of 162 members of the American Political Science Association, asking them to rank all the past presidents of the United States from best to worst. Probably to no one's great surprise, the top-ranked president was Abraham Lincoln. Most of us, though certainly not all of us, remember Lincoln as a truly great and noble man who did remarkable things for his country. But he was not always thought of in that way. In his own day, Lincoln, in fact, was not seen as a great president, and not only in the southern states, whose inhabitants as a rule truly despised him and what he stood for. Even among his supporters, he was not wildly popular. As social historian Barry Schwartz indicates in his pivotal study, Abraham Lincoln and the Forge of National Memory, when Abraham Lincoln awoke on the last day of his life, almost everyone could find something about him to dislike. Schwartz's book tries to show that Lincoln did not come to be considered great until after his death, and even then his fortunes and memory rose and fell, depending on what was happening more broadly in the country as a whole. Every turning point in American history led to a revised image of Lincoln, both who he was as a human being and what he tried to accomplish, and did accomplish. I think it is fair to say that most of us today remember Lincoln as one of the first great heroes of civil rights, as one who aggressively promoted the idea that all people are created equal, that whites and blacks deserve to be treated the same before the law, that black slaves should be set free and allowed to have the same rights and freedoms as their white owners. We generally do not remember another side of Lincoln. Prior to the Civil War, Lincoln is clearly on record for not favoring civil rights. His views changed over time, of course. Our views often do. But why do we remember only one part of his life, not the part that is discomforting to our modern views? We don't remember that Lincoln publicly stated that blacks should be set free and then deported to a colony. That he declared that blacks should not be allowed to vote, or to serve on juries, or to enjoy the privileges and responsibilities of the whites in society. That he explicitly opposed the idea of racial equality, in no small measure because he believed, in his words, that there was a physical difference between blacks and whites that would make it impossible. This is a memory of Lincoln that most of us have never had. And as incredible as it seems to us today, it is easy to document from Lincoln's own speeches and writings. As he said quite plainly and somewhat shockingly in his fourth debate with Stephen A. Douglas in 1858, "I am not, nor ever have been, in favor of bringing about in any way the social and political equality of the white and black races. And I will say in addition to this, that there is a physical difference between the white and black races, which I believe will forever forbid the two races living together on terms of social and political equality." If Lincoln publicly stated such views, which would be seen as hideously racist by us today, why is he so widely thought of today as a champion of civil rights? Is it, as some historians claim, because Lincoln eventually reversed himself and became an advocate not only of abolition, but also of complete equality? This is a controversial issue. Schwartz himself argues that we remember Lincoln the way we do today because the leaders of the civil rights movement in the early 1960s latched onto Lincoln as a voice from the past who could provide a rationale and moral justification for their push to provide full equality under the law for African Americans, a push that almost all of us realize came many, many years too late. Whether we think Lincoln completely reversed himself or not, this example of our own selective memory can be instructive. When we remember the past, whether we are thinking simply our individual thoughts or are reconstructing our previous history as a collective whole, as a society, we do so always and necessarily in light of our present situation. The past is not a fixed entity back there in time. It is always being transformed in our minds, depending on what our minds are occupied with in the here and now. As Schwartz claims, the somewhat ironic portrayal of Abraham Lincoln as a civil rights prophet demonstrates the malleability of the past and justifies Maurice Albvox's claim that collective memory is essentially a reconstruction of the past that adapts the image of historical facts to the beliefs and spiritual needs of the present. The Maurice Albvox that Schwartz invokes here is one of the truly great pioneers in the study of memory. Specifically, memory is held by social groups, collective memory. We will meet him again in Chapter 6. Albvox had a rather extreme view of how we remember. He thought that literally all of our memories are social memories, that we can't actually have any personal, private memories, but that every memory we have is necessarily influenced by, shaped by, and provided through our various social contexts. Not everyone agrees with that view, but on one point there is much wider consensus. We, whether as individuals or as members of a collective, remember the past because of its value in the present. Otherwise, we have no reason even to think about the past, whether it is our own past lives and experiences or the lives and experiences of our society. And this is the key point I'm trying to make. Sometimes, often, or always, our memories of the past are distorted precisely because of the demands of the present. Schwartz, in particular, wants to emphasize that this reality of memory does not mean that what we remember about our past as individuals or as social groups is simply fabricated and unreliable. On the contrary, most of what we remember is accurate and historical. But the way we remember it is highly selective and sometimes distorted by the reasons we choose to remember in the first place. In Schwartz's words, our modern way of remembering Lincoln valuates history by lifting the morally significant elements of Lincoln's life above the mundane. In other words, we remember the past.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.